won't be the same. So you tell me the master's role is healing for your mind, oh, your body and your soul. Yes, there is. Hallelujah. God can heal.
God can heal.
Oh, yeah.
He can heal.
And he can mend a broken.
He can mend your brokenness.
Oh yes, you will. Thank you, Lord. God knows about the situation, but with every test and every trial, there is revelation that God. That you'll have your healing. Once God works a miracle to feed your needs, go tell the world, oh, what you have received. Hallelujah,
Jesus.
Mended my broken.
He has mended my brokenness.
Give me a miracle.
Give me a miracle.
Just to fit.
To fit my need.
Can I get a witness in here? That you can lift your hands and say.
Oh, I have received.
to measure just one sin, seeking forgiveness when your heart knows within our God will not judge us on how big or how small. He looked to Calvary's blood to cover it all. Oh, the blood, the blood covered it all. Love has no boundaries since death paid it full. Jesus knew in the beginning that man would surely fall. I'm glad the Savior's precious blood, it covered it all. Tried to imagine just how this miracle took place. There's love beyond the measure. It's my God's amazing grace. Sometimes we get weary, we might stumble and fall, but just one drop of my Savior's precious blood, it covered all. The blood, yes, the blood covered it all. Love has no boundaries since death.
I have every evidence that the devil has been very busy with me today. I need your prayers. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. It is good to see you on a Friday evening like this one. And I want to thank Stacy for that song. He's wonderful. I can't hear you. Holy is his name. We serve a God who is high and lifted up. And I want to thank our music ministers for lifting our spirits. Would you say amen? for ministering to our hearts. And I want to sign the adoption papers for the little one who just sang. I said I'm ready to sign the adoption papers. As a matter of fact, I've already put her name on my will. Are you listening to me? Thank you. I love music. I just love wonderful singing. And you haven't heard anything yet. I'm going to be singing one night. You haven't heard anything yet, you know. I said, I'm going to be singing one night. You haven't heard anything yet. And since you don't know which night I'm going to sing, you can't miss any night out here. And I want to remind you of a couple of things. Number one is that I still have the two projectors inside there, and I should appoint somebody to keep reminding you every night, so that at least when I get out here, I wouldn't have to take that much time from the preaching time. But one we say at the end, what's at the end of this week? Well, I'm going to change my mind. I have to check to see what I tell you. We have the projector, and they're very expensive. I can't give it away only for a handful of people. And so if I were you, I'd make sure I invite all my friends. Now, I want to remind you that I still have some tablets left. And so let me save some time this evening and tell you that on tomorrow evening and on Sunday evening, I want to give away the tablets. If you can take 20, I believe that I'm going to send you out tomorrow. When we close at the end of the Vine service, we won't be resuming until about 4 o'clock. And so you have the entire mid-afternoon to go all across Santa Cruz and invite your friends and pray with them. And come, let's have a wonderful time together. Come tomorrow evening. And so I'm going to be taking the tablets here, and I'll ask for those persons, I'll hold them up. And so let me tell you now, if I were you, I'd make sure I have at least 21. I say 20, but just in case somebody brings 20 and you bring 21, at least you'll have an advantage by one, and it'll be yours. But just in case your neighbor brings 22, you should bring 23. And just in case your neighbor brings 23, how much should you bring? Now you get the drift. And I want to welcome you. Is there anybody here, you had 7 good dumplings today? Anybody? Now, no wonder I saw a hearse earlier. I heard a siren earlier. Something is wrong. Somebody's dying in the place. Did I see your hand? You had 7? Well, we're going to have a dumpling eating match one day, huh? You and I are going to have a dumpling eating match one day. Then it'll be the settlement of the argument, huh? Tomorrow, you can't afford to be absent. You can't afford to miss tomorrow. It's going to be a wonderful day out here as we lift up the name of Jesus, as we lift him up in worship and praise. And I'm inviting you to bring your friends. If there's anybody that's your friend who hasn't been here yet, then tomorrow is a good day to bring them. And there's going to be a wonderful baptismal service here. We're starting the divine service, by the way, we want to start our music early. We want to start our morning service at 9 o'clock. The divine service begins at 10:30, so that, as we told you last week, by the time we get to midday, we'll be closing the divine service and heading down to the riverside. So we want to start our divine service at 10:30. What time did I say? 10:30. And so you want to get, I'm going to send you home early this evening so you can get some rest and get back here together in the morning at 9 o'clock. Our divine service begins at 10:30. We'll have our praise service. We'll have our Sabbath morning discussion and Bible study and our doctrinal study. And we'll get right on in the Word. Now, on Sunday evening, I'll tell you more about Sunday evening come tomorrow. Our time is gone, and so we're going to be running by. Would you stand with me? Would you stand? If you can't stand, just get up. We're going to be standing together as we lift up a prayer to our Father in heaven. So we're standing, and I am going to ask you to bow your heads with me and lift your hearts to our Father in heaven. Oh, Lord, our God, We come this evening, unworthy, unholy, sinful and unclean. We come this evening, God, and in the depths of our hearts we know we're alive only because of a never-failing God whose goodness and mercies run from everlasting to everlasting. We thank you for saving grace. We thank you, God, that even though you are holy and high and lifted up, you've allowed us to come into your presence because of the blood that covers it all. We thank you for the covering blood of Calvary. We ask for forgiveness of sins. We ask, oh God, for the cleansing of our hearts. We pray tonight that you would allow your grace to step over our sinfulness, that you would have your own sweet way, that you would perform your own will in spite of who we are, that you, the living God, tonight will open up the fountain filled with blood, that some sinner someplace in this place and online will find grace to help in time of need. Thank you, God, for the grace you have already given. Thank you that you are a promise-keeping God. Now we pray that you would bless your word to our heart. Wrap this wretched lump of sinful clay again in a speck of blood that flows from Calvary. May your will be done and may your kingdom come, is our asking in Jesus' name. And let God's children say, amen. Amen. Tonight our subject is fixing what's broken. Fixing what's broken. And I have carried one of my older, I nearly said the oldest, but it's not the oldest Bible I have. But this Bible has traveled with me across the Caribbean, across North America. This Bible has traveled with me to England and Germany. This Bible has traveled with me to Israel and traveled with me up to Mount Carmel and traveled with me down to Jericho. This Bible has traveled with me across Jordan. And I have brought my old Bible tonight to be my company. And as he pulled up what I gave him for the screen, I heard a story that I'd like to begin with. And it speaks to how so often we allow the devil to trick us. So the story is told of this hungry tiger that was locked in a cage for 2 whole weeks. The tiger was locked in the cage for 2 weeks. And here come the sheep. And the sheep walked up and the tiger said, "Oh, little sheep, would you help out a tiger? I've been locked up in here for 2 weeks. I'm so hungry." The sheep said, "Well, if I let you out, you're going to eat me." He said, "No, sheep. Oh, no, sheep, shame on you. If you do me a good deed in letting me out, I wouldn't eat you. I wouldn't eat you, Mr. Sheep. But have pity on me. Can you see I'm hungry? Let me out." The sheep said, promise me that if I let you out, you won't eat me." He said, I promise. The sheep pulled the little latch because it was on the outside, and out come the tiger. The tiger, as it got out, stepped back, looked at the sheep, said its prayer for lunch, and pounced on the sheep. And the sheep said, "Oh, tiger, you promise. Tiger said, you foolish sheep. You see a hungry tiger locked up in the cage, and you let me out and I told you I was hungry. Eating sheep is what tigers do.
is what lions do. And here comes the donkey, and the donkey asks, what's the problem between you two fellas? The sheep said, oh, brother donkey, I saw this tiger locked up in the cage, and the tiger begged me to let him out. The tiger promised me he wouldn't eat me, and I let out the tiger, and the tiger is about to eat me. The donkey said, tiger, what's your story? Tiger said, well, I was locked up in this cage. I'm hungry. And I asked this stupid sheep to let me out because I saw the stupid sheep, and what I saw was my meal. The donkey said, let me see if I can help you out. I want to get the story from its very beginning. So tiger, I want to be able to solve this problem for both of you. I want to see how the story began. So tiger, I'm going to open the cage. You go back in the cage so I can start the story from the beginning. Tiger said, all right, it sounds fair. So the tiger goes back in the cage. The donkey locked the cage. And the sheep, learn your lesson. Never open the cage for a hungry tiger. Now go on about your business, hungry sheep. Who says a donkey are stupid? Who said the donkeys don't have any sense? The truth is, beloved, all of us sometimes get tricked, huh? And that's why we become broken. I heard a song some time ago that talks about broken people. Broken up world and broken up people. I love songs, and you dance after songs that I look for a word in. I look for a line that I can use even to talk with you. And so I did look at a song. Our topic tonight is fixing what's broken. What's our subject? Fixing what's broken. Fixing what's broken. So here's a song, and I suspect you know it very well. Each day I live, I want to be a day to give the best of me. I'm only one, but not alone. My finest neighbor, I may be broken now, but that's not the end of my story. Now turn to the neighbor behind you and say, neighbor, it looked like you're broken, but that's not the end of your story. How do we fix our brokenness? The song says, each day I live, I want to be a day to give the best of me. I'm only one, but not alone. My finest day is yet unknown. There are persons online tonight, tired of crying over their brokenness. There are persons sitting right here before me, tired of crying over their brokenness. There are preachers tired of crying over their brokenness. And sometimes we hide our brokenness behind a fine suit and a fine hairstyle and fancy clothing and fine cars, but we are broken on the inside. I hear the preacher. We try to fix it so often with so many things. And on all of our trying, the things we try still can't fix our brokenness. We go from one day to another. And the song says that through it all, the song says, my finest day is yet unknown. The devil may want to tell you that your best days are behind you. The devil may want to tell you that you've been broken so long, you've been down so long, and maybe you have come to believe that you've been down so long that getting up is no longer on your mind. Maybe you have grown so comfortable in being down, in being broken, in being messed up, and you see other church folk, and because you don't know their brokenness, you think that you are the only broken one, and you become so discouraged because you see their smile, and you don't know that behind their smile, they go home and cry themselves to sleep. Fixing what's broken. The song says, I broke my heart for every gain. To last the sweet, to taste the sweet, I face the pain. I rise and fall, yet through it all, this much remains. I want to play on these words. There's somebody online who may have sung this song. Maybe right now you're singing it. Maybe you are a dancehall party. Maybe you're a party fan. Maybe this song is one of your best renditions. Maybe it's not just Whitney Houston's song. Maybe it's your song. I broke my heart. Where do broken-hearted people go? Some go to dance halls, some go to nightclubs, some go to drugs, some go to all kinds of mess. And every time when that which they tried is through with their trying, they discover they are worse than they were before. Fixing what's broken. Where do broken hearts go? Fixing what's broken. The song says, I want one moment in time. I want one moment in time. Why is the song so meaningful to me? Because of the next line. When I'm more than I thought I could be, when all of my dreams are a heartbeat away, and the answers are all up to me. Give me one moment in time. Give me one moment in time. My mother has two brothers. The best friend of my mother's younger brother. I buried my mother, younger brother, and I think her daughter is someplace inside here. I hope, Marcia, I won't break your heart by talking about your daddy. But hear me carefully. I don't tell other people's stories. I talk the ones I have been involved in. My mother's younger brother, his best friend is Shirley Alonzo Jones. I got baptized when I was this short. Now you see I'm this tall. And ever since I got baptized, I'm talking to my uncles and aunts and all the folk in my... I'm from right down here, sir. Right down here, sir. And listen to me. I spoke to Shirley several times. We were Methodists together. I was always an Adventist. One of these evenings, I'll tell you my story. I wasn't always an Adventist. Can I testify some more? I didn't like them. You think you are the only ones who didn't like them? Me never liked them either. I call them seven devil people, and some of them still have seven devils. You look at the way they behave, and you know they have seven times seven more. But I want to tell you, beloved, that Jesus had 12 disciples and one was a devil. Are you listening to me? I said one was a devil, but he loved them just the same. Now I talked to Shirley. I said, Shirley, I said we were Methodists together. Didn't I say that? But Shirley, we as boys in Burnt Savannah, we wanted to be like Shirley. In those days in the 1980s, Afro was in, tall Afro, and big bellfoot pants, and big heel boots, and in the bellfoot pants, no, they're going to throw me out of the church, let me behave myself. And Shirley was not just a guy with, and he's always neat, listen to me carefully, he's dignified, he's neat, he's mannerly, he's respectful, he is decent, he worked for his money, never quarreled with, I've never seen him smoke, never seen him drink, never heard him quarrel. A dignified, we saw him as somebody we would aspire to be like. When I spoke with Shirley about his salvation, he said, I only want 5 minutes on my bed. He never said one moment in time, but that's exactly what comes to my mind as I reflect on Shirley. Now, here's a story. Listen to me carefully. I guess if you live anywhere between here and Black River or La Cobia, you'd know that bridge, right? There's one bridge from here before you get down to La Cobia. He's coming from the Tombstone section. He's on a bike. And he, at that time, the bridge, we have two bridges. We have the huge bridge and the little one that you would cross over to go over to Burnside Flat. He's crossing and a car almost in the banking on his side. But he escaped. I said he escaped. Are you listening to me? What do you do but give God thanks when he rescued you from danger? The song says, didn't I rescue you from danger? Rescued him from danger. And one Sunday, we were riding down the road. I saw Danny out here earlier. Danny is my best friend from Burn Savannah. And I'd ride Danny's bike. When I was courting in Silo, I'd ride Danny's bike to look for a coolie girl. Are you listening to me? Shirley was riding Melville's bike. Where's Melville? Here's Melly right here. Shirley was riding Melly's S90, was it? A C100. I was riding Danny's C50. And we were heading towards Mountainside. He stopped to pick up a chicken for his mother, turned back, and I went on my way. I was going over south to see a friend of mine, Pastor Milton Gregory. I came back to Burnside, and I saw a crowd at my mother's gate. I saw Shirley's mother. I saw my mother's other brother. And I jumped off the bike, and I wondered, what's wrong? And they said, Shirley is dead. I said, no, that's not true. We were riding together down the road. Mother said to me, he came back to drop a chicken for his mother. Here's Melly right here. He's on Melville's bike. And after dropping the chicken off, he turned back to head on the road. There's a long stretch, and we would love riding down the long stretch, then lean the bike, you see, around the corner. And he couldn't make the corner. I'm talking about fixing what's broken. He couldn't make the corner. And when I asked my mother, what's wrong with him? They said, he's dead. I said, no, he can't be. He's not dead. We were together just a moment earlier. We call the corner Calder's Corner. They said, if you ride down to Calder's Corner, you'll still see blood on the utility pole. And in order to satisfy my own curiosity, I jumped on the bike and we rode down back the corner. And there were still bits of blood and parts of skull and hair. When I talked with him about his salvation, he said to me, all he wanted was 5 minutes on his bed. Did I tell you, he never quarreled, never smoked, didn't drink, a decent fellow, tall afro, well-dressed, nicely dressed, elegant chap. But hear the preacher. We can't fix what's broken by going halfway. We can't fix what's broken by merely refusing to drink. Follow me tonight, beloved. I'm coming down your street. 2 weeks afterwards, they asked me to preach at my friend's funeral in the Methodist church. There was standing room only. The churchyard filled with young people. Inside the church, not even standing room. Preached. They walked with Shirley's casket. Young men taking turns, They didn't allow the hearse to carry him. We walked with his casket from the church all the way down to the cemetery in the family's private burial place. But all of the love we had for him could never fix what was broken. All of the tears we shed could never heal what was broken. And as the casket was lowered, I looked in his mother's face and I knew she had a broken heart. And all of our commiserations, all of our prayers, all of our crying with her could never heal the hole in her heart. How do we fix what's broken? The song says, give me one moment in time. Give me one moment in time. When I'm more than I thought I could be. When all of my dreams are a heartbeat away. And the answers are all up to me. Give me one moment in time. When I'm racing with destiny. Racing with destiny. You and I have an appointment with God. And there are some things we've got to fix before we get to the day of the appointment. Listen to me. There's a hole in our heart. We are broken people with broken lives and broken dreams and broken marriages and broken relationships and broken issues. Every day of our lives, we go from one brokenness to another. And sometimes money can't fix it, and dancehall can't fix it, and sex can't fix it, and drinking can't fix it, and Afro can't fix it. And listen to the preacher. Fixing what's broken is an urgent issue. We're racing with destiny. Before you leave here tonight, before you walk out of this tent, before you leave here tonight, hear the preacher. You're online, you're in this place. God alone can fix what's broken in humanity. Fixing our brokenness. Fixing our brokenness. The song, where do broken hearts go? Where do broken hearts go? And in the song, I look in your eyes. And I wish I could share some more, but let me put that aside. Where do broken hearts go? Our greatest brokenness is our separation from God. Our world is broken. Our country is broken. Our community is broken. Our homes are broken. Our children are broken. Our lives are broken because our greatest brokenness is our separation from God. I go to Isaiah chapter 59. Isaiah chapter 59. In the first verse, it says, behold, the Lord's hand is not short that he cannot save. If it were up to God alone, the whole world would be saved. How do I know that? Can I ask you to repeat with me a favorite text in the Bible from St. John? Which one would you pick? St. John 3 and verse 16 that says what? For God so what? For God so love who? That he gave his only begotten son. That what? Whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now let me wheel and come again. So hear the text. I want you, wherever you see world, and whosoever. Put yourself there. So let's go. For God so loved me. For God so loved Glenn Octavia Samuels. For God so loved. Call your own name. For God so loved. Now I can't hear you. I want to hear you shout your own name. For God so loved. Now let me give the folk online. I want to hear. I want the folk online to type your name in the chat. For God so. I want to type in the chat. For God so loved. And put your name there. While the folk in the tent will shout their name. Let's go again. For God so loved. That he gave his only begotten son. That if. I want to hear you call your name. That if. Should believe on him. Then so and so should not perish. But have everlasting life. The Bible says here in Isaiah 59 and verse 1. Behold, the Lord's hand is not short that he cannot save. Neither is his ear heavy that he can't hear. If it were up to God, you would never, could never go to hell. By the way, hear the preacher. It's an old song that I heard from my grandmother's friend. My great-grandmother had a friend that used to wrap her head and put some pencils up there. Huh? And she had a song that says, if I should die and my soul should be lost. So you know it. So if you should die and your soul should be lost, it would be nobody's fault but yours. The Bible said in answering the question regarding our greatest brokenness, the preacher says, our greatest brokenness is our separation from God. And the Bible said, the Lord's hand is not short that he cannot save, neither is his ear heavy that he can't hear your prayer, neither is his ear heavy that he can't hear your cry. Verse 2 said, But what? But our iniquity have separated between you and your God so that he can't hear. Are you listening to me, beloved? I want you to understand tonight, as the song says, if you try to imagine, you would understand that the blood can cover it all. For God so loved you that he gave his son that his blood can cover your sins. But listen to me. Every night you come by here, every day you come by here, God sits in heaven and is asking you one question. Why are you delaying to get the broken necks fixed? Why are you waiting? Why are you delaying? I said to Shirley, hurry up, man. Time is running out. And Shirley said, all I need, Sammy, is just 5 minutes on my bed. He never got the 5 minutes. Listen to me carefully. Can I talk to you about one more? And these guys, we grew up together. I was baptized as a young little fellow. And there was one guy in our community. He had those 14-speed or 7-speed bicycle with the handle turned down. And Presley stopped at the church gate. It was about a month after my baptism or shortly after the baptism. And we would still talk. And he rode the bicycle, stopped by the church. And Orville and I, we were always reading the Bible. There was a huge logwood tree by the church gate. We were under the tree and he stopped there talking to us. I said, man, park the bicycle and come on inside. He said, Sammy, man, no, I soon come. Not ready yet. Got to get some girls first. Little fella, you know, jovial fella. And he rode off. Hear me carefully. The devil is no friend of ours. I don't tell you these things to make you scared. And if you notice, I tell you stories that these guys knew happened. We grew up together. He rode off. Dunstan and I went back inside the little church. We barely sat down when Tom Williams, another bike rider, and Tom came shouting, and he called up my name and he said, Presley. I said, no, Presley can't, Dad. Orville and I jumped out the church, rode on the bike, just past his gate. I said, just below his own gate. A white Ford F-150 knocked him off the bicycle, and the handle of the cycle went straight through his chest. And we peeped under Mr. Burton's van and saw the curled up body of my little friend. Listen to me carefully. All around us, we are surrounded by evidences after evidence after evidence that the devil wants to kill us in our sins. Every day of our lives, we are surrounded by broken people who, when they fail to trust God, all that happens, they become more and more broken. Are you listening to me? Oh, what needless pain we carry. And the Lord God says, his hands are not too short, his ears are not too heavy. But he said, our sins have separated us from him. Are you listening to me? The word of God is so clear and powerful, beloved. I wish I could take my time with it. The Bible said, hear the word of the living God. He says, we grope for the wall like the blind, that's verse 10. We grope as if we had no eyes. We stumble at noonday. Listen to the word of God. The Lord said, we are behaving as if we can't see. Look around you, young man. Look around you. How many funeral services have you attended? Listen to me, young lady. How many sermons have you listened to? And hear the Lord God says, why are you groping in broad daylight as if you're walking in darkness? Why is it that we find our broken necks so difficult to fix? We have not known who God is. There's an ignorance, a lack of knowledge of the true God, a lack of knowledge of who the true God is. Did you know that there are churches tonight in the U.S. and over the door is the sign Church of the Living Devil? And people flock in the congregation. They make no secret that they are devil worshipers. A song that says, think backwards, walk backwards. I wish I could share some songs with you. But hear the preacher. I wish the young man had brought back my... Listen to the preacher. We need to know who God is. We need to know him for ourselves. Are you listening to me? If you ever get to know God, can I tell you two great things that would happen? Number one is that you would never stay broken, because you would know the greatest love of all can happen to you. If you love God, learning to love yourself is not the greatest love of all. The greatest love is the love that God has for you. Can I talk to you? There's nobody here who can tell God anything about you that will make God love you any less. I said, there's nobody here who can tell God anything about you that will make God love you any less. And I want you to know, beloved, what he asks for is a full surrender, even with your brokenness and our messed up lives and our can't bother with ourselves life. He said, when you can't bother with yourself and when you think you've got it all, bring it to Jesus. He said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. The Bible says it in Hosea chapter 4. He says, my people, I wish you could understand the preacher. No matter what you've done, no matter how many sins you have, God still calls you his own. He said, my people are destroyed for lack of. Some of us take God for granted. I want to be plain tonight. I don't preach fancy sermons. You can get that someplace else. I'm just a plain old Bible preacher. The Lord God says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. And he said, it is not because they could not know. It's because they refuse to know. He said, because they have rejected knowledge, he has rejected them. Well, preacher, how do you mean we've rejected knowledge? Where can we find God's knowledge? Where can we find God's will? How can I discover God's will for my life? Where can I find God's instruction? It's in the book. I said it's in the book. And I walk with my old Bible. This old Bible, we've been to Germany. This old Bible, we've been to England. This old Bible, we've been to North America and South America. We've been across the Caribbean. This old Bible, we've been up to Mount Carmel together. This old Bible, we've been down to Jericho together. This old Bible, we've crossed the Sea of Galilee together. But let me tell you something, beloved. No matter where you go with it, the word of God has got to be in your heart. The lady said, you know, well, don't pee in the house. So I'm going to put the Bible on my bed. And when I'm going to sleep, I'm going to put the Bible right under my pillow and put my head down on the Bible. But you know what the Lord God said in his word? Thy word have I hid in my heart. Unless the word of God is in your heart, all you'll wake up with is a big headache. God said to Moses, he said, tell Israel that these words which I command them must first be in their heart. And then they shall teach them diligently unto their children. You can't teach what you do not know. And you can't lead where you have not gone. Where you're not prepared to go. So God said to Moses, tell Israel, if we go have a better world and a better church and a better home, the word of God has got to be in their heart. Are you listening to me? So Jesus Christ, when he came, he said in John 10 and verse 27, he says, my sheep, remember, he said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. No matter what sin you've done, no matter how broken you are, no matter how messed up you are, the Lord God Almighty still call you as his own. And the greatest pain on the heart of God is to watch his own drift away from him. Are you listening to me? And Ellen White says, in the day of judgment, when he shall have to bring down fire, he will have to destroy the wicked out of mercy to themselves, because a loving God can't allow the world to go on being broken forever. Too much bloodshed and war and violence. I'm tired of having to cry over the brokenness of others. I'm tired of having to cry over my own mistake. I'm tired of funeral services. I'm tired of having to watch young people who've broken their lives and gone a mess and turned to drugs. I'm tired of burying folk who've committed suicide. I'm tired of folk who who've been mistreated and abused and neglected. I've seen old poor folk who've done their best to raise their children and they've been left abandoned. It's a broken world with broken people and broken hearts and broken lives, and God wants to fix the brokenness. So he says, my sheep. Bless the Lord God. I gotta help you understand this. I told you, this Bible trouble with me to Israel, across Palestine. We were in an air-conditioned bus and we got to some nomadic shepherds, the kibbutz, and we stopped to chat with them. All we saw was just barren land, hardly any green grass. And there was a little water hole, and hundreds of heads of sheep were drinking from the little water hole. We saw these shepherds in groups sitting down, and they were friendly. We walked over past Bowers, Clinton Lloyd Bowers, and Astor Bowers, and President from the Bahamas, Katie Halbury, and a group of us were together. We engaged them in a discussion. And then we said, how will you know your own? Because they all have the same color. They all look alike. Almost the same height. Almost everything about them on the outside look the same. And so we asked them, how do you know your own? And when you want to leave, how do you get your own out of the crowd? And they said, well, you guys, where are you from? And we chatted with them. And we said, Jamaica. You know, there's something about this place called Jamaica. I walked into a store in Israel to buy a bottle of drinking water. And I had on a Jamaican t-shirt. And the man said, Jamaica, no problem, man. No problem, man. And I said, have you been there? He said, no, but I know Bob Marley's song. No problem, man. Well, let me come back to the shepherd. And so he said, well, we chatted about Jamaica. He said, well, it's almost time, so you're going to see the answer to your question. And one got up, pulled his stuff up, but the sheep were still there drinking and nibbling. You know, around the water hole, there's some green grass. Sheep there nibbling, nibbling, nibbling. They said a sheep gets lost 6 feet at a time. A sheep can't see far, and it keeps nibbling, 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 and sometimes it doesn't know it's getting deeper and deeper in trouble. The sheep doesn't know it's wandering, and that's why the sheep's safety depends on the love of the shepherd. I just said something. The safety of the sheep depends on the love of the shepherd. I'll come back to that tomorrow. I said the safety of the sheep depends on the love of the shepherd. And I'm glad we have a shepherd who loves with an everlasting love. I'm glad we have a shepherd who can fix our brokenness, no matter how broken we are. So let me come back to the question. How do you separate your sheep from the crowd? I said, that's easy. He got up, pulled up his knapsack and picked up his stick and his stuff, his bucket, and he gave a whistling sound. And it's like they all stood at attention. They were drinking and eating. He gave a whistling sound. And hear me, my eyes popped open. I said, I told you earlier, they all look alike. I told you earlier, they were almost the same height, drinking in the same place. But when he gave the sound, I saw the sheep wriggle their tail out of the crowd. Wriggle their tail out of the crowd and lined up beside the man who gave the whistle. The other one gave another sound and another set of sheep wriggle out. Now Jesus, this Palestinian preacher, Jesus, this Jewish preacher who uses symbols and analogies so that folk could identify, they know my voice. They know my voice. They follow me. Watch this, watch this. And he gives it. eternal life only to the ones who follow him. Are you listening to me? And so it doesn't matter what name is over your church. The safety is not in the name of the church. The safety is in following Jesus. Are you listening to me? The safety is in following the true shepherd, because he's the only one who can fix my brokenness. He's the only one who can fix your brokenness. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. Fixing what's broken. How do we fix what's broken? Apart from a lack of knowledge, apart from not knowing him, what else has led and is leading to our brokenness? The preacher is a plain preacher. Apart from the fact that we are ignorant sometimes of who the true God is, and our ignorance is because we fail to hear his voice. Listen to me. Like sheep, we're sometimes drawn away by every little blade of green grass. We're drawn away by every little blade of green grass. And we don't look down the road. We just look at the blade of green grass. We look for immediate gratification. We look for urgent satisfaction. And we don't know that the devil is dropping one blade here and one blade there and one blade there. And his plan is to lead us further and further away from the true shepherd, away from the place of safety, leading us into further brokenness. I know, whereas I may pick a line from a song, the same song can be a source of danger to some young person, because they listen to the rock and they're led away by the lyrics. But hear me, you can listen to the whispering winds of eternity and find a word from God. Are you listening to me? So the sheep gets lost. The shepherds say 6 feet at a time. It can't see further enough, but you've got to lift up your head and look yonder. Are you listening to me? So he said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. I give you one more reason for our brokenness. Fasten up your seatbelt. Straighten up. Can I tell you another reason for our brokenness? Broken marriage. Can I tell you another reason for broken hearts? We have turned back from following God. We have turned away our eyes from the truth of God. We have turned away our ears from the word of God. Hear the preacher. I want to read for you Jeremiah. What book did I say? Jeremiah. Jeremiah. And the Bible said, I'm looking for the text in Jeremiah. I'm going to, I think, the third chapter. Jeremiah chapter 3. He's got something on the screen, but I want to go a little earlier. It says, surely as a wife treacherously. I did tell you I used that text on Wednesday, right? And I told you on Wednesday I might come back to it. You thought I'd forgotten. As a wife treacherously departs from her husband. You could say, as a husband treacherously departs from his wife. He said, so have you dealt treacherously with me. And he said, O house of Israel. Can I explain what that means to you? It means the whole church is in danger. Are you listening to me? Oh, house of Israel. You could say, oh, Jamaica, or oh, world. Hear the preacher. I'm moving towards the conclusion. Listen to this. He then said, I'm reading for you. He then said in verse 22, I asked the question, how can we fix our brokenness? And he gives a simple solution. Return ye backsliding children. You didn't hear me. He said, return. Return. Another word for that is turn around. In my early days, Carol Cranston would sing a song. You've been running, running, running for a long, long time. You've been running, running with no peace of mind. How long will you run away, a fugitive from God? Why won't you turn, turn, turn around? Why do you stray? Can't you see God the Father waits to welcome you home? Here the text says, return to me. Return to me. Return to me, O children. He's speaking to all of the broken. Return to me, and I will heal your brokenness. I'll heal your backslidings. Behold, we come to thee, for thou art the Lord our God. Beloved, hear the preacher. You can't fix it by yourself. You can't fix it by yourself. And if you've been looking to a man to fix your hurt, you may end up with more hurt. If you've been looking to a woman to fix your hurt, you'll end up with more hurt. Isaiah 45, 22 said, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. I want to be in a place where there'll be no more brokenness. I want to be in a land where there'll be no more broken hearts. I jumped on the plane because the parents couldn't handle it. The Miami-Dade police call. Jumped on the plane. The friend picked me up at the airport and rushed me down to the police headquarters. They piloted me to the house. They had the keys. And inside the private bedroom, they had just removed the two bodies. Two young people who were stone in love. Listen to me carefully. What do you do when love goes south? One, dead on the bed, with her licensed firearm in her hand. One, dead on the floor, with his licensed M9 in his hand. They had a dispute. They had a disagreement. And they both went for their guns. You live in the land of the quick and the dead. He killed her and then killed himself. It was my task. Son, could you play for me softly and tenderly? It was my task to pull their stuff together. And in pulling their belongings together, I saw pictures that once would tell the story of young lovers. I saw intimate pictures of romantic unity. Do you know what brought the death? She'd gone down to the Miami Maranatha church. She'd listened to the preacher, to the backslider, who needed to come back to Jesus. And she was contemplating in her heart that he can't fix her brokenness. She was contemplating. She's a fine business head, a great job, a fancy car, a nice house, a decent asset. But she realized that there's nothing that a man can give in exchange for his soul. She realized that the only source that can fix the brokenness is Jesus. And she made up her mind to come back to Jesus. And he, in his wild jealousy, thought it was another man that she found. Really, it was true. She found a better man than he was. She found the real man. She found God's man. She found the only man that could fix her brokenness. She told him, "This is it." They had a quarrel, and that's how the story ended. Listen to me. A man came to Jesus. He was tired of being broken. He was sick with a brokenness that would take his life. He couldn't go to church because of his brokenness. He couldn't worship in the temple because of his brokenness. The New Living Translation said, "Suddenly he ran to Jesus." The King James Version said, "Behold, he coming to Jesus." The American Standard Translation said, "He rushed to Jesus." And he said, "Lord, if thou wilt, you can make me whole." The leper realized that leprosy would kill him. And when he found out, Matthew said, suddenly he ran to Jesus. When society says that Jesus shouldn't be bothered with him, when polite society says he should keep on screaming out his sin and screaming out his suffering and screaming out the stuff that is destroying him, he was tired of facing his brokenness. He was tired of screaming out his deluge. This day, when he realized that Jesus was passing his way, when he realized that unless he should do something now urgently, then brokenness would not only be his past and his present, but brokenness would be his future. And this moment, he said, "Devil, I can't fix the past. I can't change my yesterday. I can't dry up the tears I have already cried. I can't mend the brokenness in my yesterday. But give me this moment in time. Give me this one moment in time. Because I discover in this moment I can be more than I am already. I can be greater than I have already been." And so he ran to Jesus. He didn't care what the others were saying. He didn't care what the others were doing. I don't know if he heard the voice of Jesus saying, "My sheep hear my voice." I don't know if he heard the voice of Jesus saying, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." The only thing I know, he must have felt in his heart, "If I don't do something now, I'll be broken forever." The only thing I know, the leper must have been tired of seeing other lepers die in their leprosy. But he made up his mind that day. And the Bible said, he suddenly ran to Jesus. And I'm glad St. John 6 and verse 37 said, him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. I'm glad the Old Testament said it. You can come now and let's reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. I don't care where you've wandered. I don't care how broken up you are. I don't care how messed up you are. You may be a murderer tonight, but the blood of Jesus and the power of the Holy Ghost can fix it. So I said, come every soul that sin oppressed, come every broken heart, come every messed up life. If you're online tonight and you can't come physically, come spiritually. Type in the chat, oh Lamb of God, I come. Type in the chat, I come. If you're here tonight, then stand up with the preacher. Stand up with me tonight. Stand up with the preacher. Hear me. Fixing our brokenness. Fixing our brokenness. Stand up tonight. I see a note saying this in St. Thomas, a 23-year-old struggling to return to Christ. Well, hear me, 23-year-old. Hear me, 33-year-old. Hear me, 43-year-old. Hear me, 93-year-old. No matter how long you've been broken, come on to Jesus. I open right now by the power of the Holy Ghost. I open to you. Somebody here, you're tired of being broken. You're tired of your sins. You're tired of straying. You're tired of crying. You're tired of messing up. You're tired. You're tired. You're tired. You're tired. You're tired. And you're saying, Jesus, help. Help this poor sinner. Is that you? And come on. Don't look around you. Come, start walking forward. Come on. Come on. You need Jesus to fix your brokenness. Don't just stand there on. Want
for
to have
a country
your brokenness fixed. Fixing what's broken. Fixing what's broken. Hear me, young lady. Of the one who can heal your broken heart. And some calling tonight. Every person in the hearing of my voice, you want God to fix your brokenness, then come on. You want God to fix your brokenness, then come. Come on. You want God to fix your brokenness. Come on. Walk out of your row and come. Hear me, young lady. Hear me, sir. He's calling you. I see you come. I see you come. He's calling you. He's calling you. You want God to fix your brokenness. I don't know what's causing the brokenness. The man said, suddenly he ran to Jesus. What do you need tonight? Is it mercy? He has it. Is it forgiveness? He has it. Is it strength? He has it. Is it power over bad habits? He has it.
Will end inside. There's just a few more
days. The leper didn't hesitate. The text said, suddenly he ran to Jesus. He ran to Jesus. Would you come to Christ tonight? Would you come to Christ tonight?
I'm longing for you.
And someday.
And someday.
I stand. God bless you, sir.
I stand.
God bless you, sir. Where my home,
where my home
will be eternal,
shall be eternal.
He said,
beautiful land,
hold a moment,
sweet beautiful
land. I want to make it as plain as I can. I want to make it as plain as I can without the sound as he plays softly. And I'm going to ask him to play that song, Just As I Am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me and that thou bidst me come to thee. O Lamb of God, I come, I come. And if those words describe your situation, then come on right now. Yes, sir. Come, come. Shirley had the invitation. Presley had the invitation. Come, come. Just as you are, you can't fix yourself. Come, come just as you are. Do you want to be God's sheep? Then you've got to hear God's voice. You've got to know who he is. He's a loving God, but his justice and his mercy join hands together. So he gave his life to satisfy the debt that you couldn't pay. And he gave his mercy so that you can live.
I am.
Is that you? Come! Come on to Jesus. Come on to Jesus. You may have come several times before. You may have been down here several times before. But I call you again tonight by the grace of God. Call you again tonight by the love of God. As we bring the service to a close tonight.
Of God, I come.
I come. Our heads are bowed. But is there somebody else down there saying, Pastor, I want God to have mercy on this sinful soul of mine. I want the Lord God to have mercy on my soul. And tonight, you've heard the word and you are conscious of your brokenness. You want the Lord God to have mercy on your soul, to have mercy on your life. Then I ask you to hurry and come. It's my final call tonight. It's the last call tonight. It's the last call tonight. I have one final moment, and there's no song in this one, not even the playing. Like me, you're going to church. Like many others, you're going to church. But you're determined by the grace of God that you want the rest of your life to be the best of your life. I see you come, young people. There is no music now. I'm speaking heart to heart with you. I'm speaking to your intelligence. It's not about anybody else now. It's about you and God. And you need him to fix it for you. I see you come over on my left. I see you come. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I see you come. Come on.
Oh, bless the Lord. I see my pastor walking with a gentleman, holding hand, brother to brother, coming down to the altar. I see you come over on my left. There is no music, just the voice of God speaking to your own heart. Come on. I see you come. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I see you come. 13. I see you come, sir, from way down the back, from that side to the center. I see your white cap, and if I see you, God sees you too. Come on. Come on. Somebody else tonight. Somebody else tonight. This is a cry from the heart of God. It's a rescue mission. It's a rescue mission. God bless you. God bless. It's a rescue mission. I see you come from down on my left. I see you come, sir. It's a rescue mission. Who else God wants to rescue tonight? Who else God wants to rescue tonight? Somebody else on whose heart the Holy Ghost is knocking. Somebody else tonight, you're online, but you need to make that decision. Somebody in Florida getting baptized tomorrow who have been joining us out here. There may be others. Call us up. Send a number. We can make contact. He can fix your brokenness. I'm done. He can fix your brokenness. I'm done. But there's somebody else who needs to come. Come on, young lady. If your friend won't come, you come by yourself. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. Our heads are bowed and it's time to pray. In times like these, if you don't have company, come on by yourself. It's better to walk by yourself to the kingdom of God than to go to hell in a crowd. It's time to pray. Oh Lord our God, in the silence of our hearts, in the quietness of this place, we come tonight thanking you for mercy, thanking you for pardon, that you're fixing broken hearts, you are fixing broken lives, you are fixing broken dreams. And tomorrow, God, as a symbol of the healing you are giving, you'll take us down to the river. You'll bury the old man. We don't have the strength. We don't have the power. But like the leper, we said, Jesus, if you're willing, we're coming just as we are, because you alone can fix our brokenness. Tonight, to the altar, and tomorrow, God, grant victory at the water. Tonight, Jesus, somebody here at this altar didn't even know when they were leaving home that they were going to come to a place where you are working a miracle on their heart. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for there is nothing that's impossible with you. There's no sin that the blood can't wash away. There's no weak sinner so weak that you can't strengthen them. There's no one so hopeless that you can't lift them up and give them hope. We join our hearts together in intercessory prayer. Lord, we place no card in anyone's hand tonight. But we ask you, let the Holy Ghost, let the Holy Ghost do what a card cannot do. We beg you in the name of Jesus, according to the multitude of your loving kindness, work a miracle tonight. There's a young lady here, God, who's doubting whether or not she can go through with it. But remind her, If Lazarus could come from the grave, she can make it to the baptismal fountain. She can make it to the kingdom of God. There's a young lady here, God, I talked and prayed with her. I know the struggle. I know the struggle, Father. If she is losing her marriage, help her not to lose her salvation. Tomorrow to the water. To seal the decision. To seal the commitment. To lay down the burden. To study war no more. The fighting is over. It's time for surrender. Thank you for victory. God, I thank you for young men who can't even wait for tomorrow. Their minds made up, hearts bubbling over, waiting for sunrise to come, waiting for the sermon to be over, to walk down in the waters of baptism. Take us home tonight. But Jesus, you know that struggling heart. That one that's halting between two opinions. That young man, God, that lady. That backslider who is saying they're going to wait until they can keep it out. God, I pray for that stubborn heart. There's nothing standing in their way except their own doubts. There's nothing standing in their way but themselves. They are their own stumbling block. I pray, Almighty God, you'll break the hand of the devil that he may let go of your child. Pray tonight, Jesus, for victory. And Lord, the struggle is real. There are some with some real problems. But remind them that as long as this world lasts, there will always be problems. There'll always be issues. And it's time to get ready so you can fix our brokenness once and for all. And now in the sweet name of Jesus, take these children home safely. Write their names in the Lamb's Book of Life. Send extra battalion from heaven, God, because the battle will be intensifying between tonight and the riverside. Send extra help from the sanctuary. Send an angel now, God, for there's trouble in some house waiting to pounce on somebody here at the altar. Send an angel, God, to fly the trap of the enemy. I leave it in your hands. Take us all home safely. Watch over us while we sleep tonight. Whatever you do, Jesus, don't leave us in our sins. Let the blood be applied afresh. Take us home in the arms of sweet deliverance. Take us home, God, with the assurance that you've never lost a battle. Take us home, God, with a song of victory.
So you enter into this building. You brought your burdens, brought your pain.